I'm Carrie Holt, and welcome back to News Channel 4. Our coverage before the break brought you the story of Justin Bieber's recent deportation to Canada. And now, we bring you another story of another radical icon forced into exile. Jean-Paul Marat, the famous journalist of the French Revolution. Tonight, our reporters will bring you the inside scoop of this controversial figure's intriguing life and his unusual death. Carrie Holt, our French specialist, is in France itself with the details of Marat's early life. Over to you, Carrie.
Oui, bonjour, je m'appelle Carrie Holt. Je suis la correspondante française. Aujourd'hui, je suis là à Paris pour vous expliquer la vie du très bien connu Jean-Paul Marat. Avant que son rôle dans la Révolution française, il n'était pas tellement différent que quelqu'un bien connu et aimé parmi nous-mêmes. Vous connaissez Justin Bieber. Tous les deux ont commencé leur voyage dans la vie avec l'inspiration de devenir fameux. Né en Suisse, Marat a quitté la maison à 16 ans pour poursuivre une vie des sciences comme médecin en étudiant à Paris où je suis là. Alors, il voulait trouver la richesse et la gloire, un peu comme Justin Bieber avec ses musiques. Il a déménagé à Londres pour s'établir comme médecin officiel en ville. Là-bas, il a trouvé des amis, beaucoup comme Justin Bieber, avec son ami Usher, qui a aidé avec son métier. Et ses amis, ils lui ont donné une grande influence avec son travail politique et philosophique autour de ses travaux scientifiques. Alors, pendant cette époque, il a écrit plein de choses, incluant The Chains of Slavery, où il critique l'aristocratie en Angleterre. Plus tard, il a continué à offrir cette concentration sur l'aristocratie avec ses écrits politiques. Après l'Angleterre, il est retourné à le continent d'Europe où il est devenu le médecin officiel pour le petit frère de Louis XIV. Cependant, encore bien similaire à Justin Bieber, avec tous ses haters, Jean-Paul Marat, voilà, il est là. Il a trouvé quelques haters lui-même. Ces personnes l'inspiraient de quitter sa poste de médecin et la vie des sciences. Alors c'est tout. Maintenant, je vous ramène à Carrie et elle va continuer avec la vie de Marat et la Révolution française. Merci à tous et vive la France.
Oh my! What an excellent report. Most of that was just so advanced, went right over my head. Back to Marat. After a fallout with the elites of the scientific world, who snubbed several of his papers and passed him over for a nomination to France's Academy of Science, Marat turned back to a discipline in which he had previously dabbled: political commentary. Historians disagree over whether Marat's increasingly vitriolic journalism on revolutionary politics simply reflected the growing radicalism of the time, or actually played a part in increasing it. Channel 4 staged an experiment to find out. We have someone in the field right this minute. Over to you, Katie.
Marat's newsletter, Friend of the People, ran from 1789 until the day after he died. While it eventually gave voice to the concerns of the radical revolutionaries and sans-culottes, it began with a more moderate message, mirroring the increasing radicalization of
the revolution itself.
At first, Marat intended his publication to simply inform citizens of current political events. But because the journal was edited by Marat alone, it eventually became saturated with his own political ideology. At first, Marat was reluctant to accept the radical call for republicanism, instead arguing for reforms that would operate within the framework of the constitutional monarchy to guarantee additional freedoms for the Third Estate. Like the radical revolutionaries around him, Marat grew increasingly convinced that groups within France were plotting to halt the revolution. This increasing sense of paranoia is evident in articles of Friend of the People, where Marat levels accusations against everyone, from the National Guard, to the National Assembly, to the Commune of Paris, to the royal family itself.
Marat faced frequent arrests for his criticisms and often took refuge in the French sewers, where he somehow managed to continue publications.
Marat's articles often praised mob violence, describing events like the September massacres as ripe for revenge by the oppressed public. Some historians claim that Marat's journal played a key role in motivating the sans-culottes to commit specific acts of violence, such as the September massacres or the forcing of the royal family from their home. But could the angry musings of one sewer-dwelling man really have this dramatic of an effect?
We're on our way to see if we can incite our own mob, using Marat's friend of the people.
How does it make you feel when you read it?
Makes me feel bored.
Do you feel like rioting when you read this?
No.
What do you think about the events in France?
It's a country. It starts with an F. Fries. French fries.
Wow, Katie, if that's not groundbreaking journalism, I don't know what is. While Marat's writing may not incite rebellion in modern cities of today, they certainly garnered public support in revolutionary France. In fact, Marat's radicalism gained so much approval that he was eventually able to leave the sewers to publish openly. That's a journalist's dream, am I right? He also served as a delegate to the National Convention, where he frequently clashed with less radical Girondist representatives. Let's go to Paris reporter Hannah Nolan, who's currently outside the site of the former convention with the latest details on all that drama. Hannah, over to you.
I'm coming to you live outside the National Convention, where Jean-Paul Marat gave his famous speech. First, let's have a brief recap of Jean-Paul Marat's life with the convention. He was elected to the National Convention in September 1792. Some of his beliefs include the thought that Louis XVI should not be accused of anything before his acceptance of the National Constitution in 1791, but he did believe that Louis's death would ultimately be good for the people. Along with this, Marat thought that the monarchy should be abolished and advocated for tax and military reforms. He was supported by Parisian political allies in the convention and in the streets. Marat was not only a huge supporter of the sans-culottes, but was a symbol for the Montagnards, the radicals. Marat was made a symbol of Montagnards by his opposition, the Girondins. Marat fought with the Girondins, and they put him on trial, but he was then acquitted for. Marat was not in a real position of power within the Montagnards. This speech, the reason why I'm standing here today, is a huge way the late Marat is known. In this speech, he was defending himself against the charges from his political opposition brought against him, accusing him to be a factionist and anarchist, looking for power and more. Here are some of the great lines of his speech. 1. If they had not ceaselessly represented me as a factionist and anarchist, a drinker of blood, an ambitious man who looks for supreme power under the title of Tribune, Tremivore, Direct and Director, if the nation, completely undeceived, has recognized the perfidy of these impostures. 2. For it's the principle of the right that no citizen shall be censored without first being heard. 3. For that is to say, by 200 men, 210 enemies of the country against 92 defenders of liberty. And 4. It is essentially inherent in the functions of... Those are just a few lines of a speech that shows Marat's impressive oratory skills. And I'll end this segment with his last line. If after reading any doubts remain, I'm here to remove them. Back to you, Carrie.
Thanks, Hannah. That was groundbreaking.
Marat's rousing oratory
did little to patch up his relationship with the Paris Girondists, motivating one woman, Charlotte Corday, to take matters into her own hands. My kind of woman. News Channel 4 was mysteriously unable to reach Ms. Corday. However, we sent forensic reporter Laura Zwirling to the crime scene to bring you exclusive details on the scandal. Over to you, Zwirling.
I'm here at the scene of the crime where Jean-Paul Marat's life ended and Charlotte Corday's infamy began. On July 13, 1793, Corday, a young Girondin supporter from Normandy, sought an audience with the esteemed Marat, claiming that she wanted his protection. Marat granted her this audience, meeting with her while he took a medicinal bath right here for a skin disease he may have acquired in the Parisian sewers. When Corday arrived at this meeting, it was revealed that she was a Girondin when she listed dissenters from Normandy. According to our sources, Marat allegedly declared that these dissenters would be put to death. In response, Corday pulled a knife from her dress and proceeded to stab Marat to death. She remained at the scene of the crime until she was arrested, convicted by the Revolutionary Tribunal, and sentenced to death, only a few short days after the murder. Charlotte Corday, a descendant of nobles, was among Girondin refugees when she decided to return to Paris to work for their cause, singling out Marat because of his newspaper's influence over the people. Corday declined to comment on this story, which News Channel 4 speculates that it may be because she was guillotined several centuries ago. Despite his untimely death, Marat's legacy continues. He was praised as a martyr because the Montagnards' political triumph over the Girondins came simultaneously to his death. More recently, 21 French towns and one Soviet battleship were all named after Marat, a man who fanned the flames of revolution and then died in a bathtub. Carrie, back to you.
Well, folks, that's all we have time for tonight. Don't forget to join us next week as we bring you live coverage of our annual 21st Mr. Former Dictator Beauty Contest. A recent straw poll has Maximilian Robespierre, a personal favorite, at the back of the pack. Until then, folks, remember, don't let this be you. I'm Carrie Holt. Have a good night.